Good morning, children. So we are once again together on this online session. Now today the topic that we have is a poem which is known as Tumai of the Elephants. It is from your MCB book, Unit 1, Section 3. Now this poem is written by Rudyard Kipling. Rudyard Kipling is an English writer who was born in 1865 in Mumbai, then Bombay. His father was a professor in an art school. Even though he spent his early childhood in India, he went to school in England. Now, when he finished his studies, he went back to India and worked as a journalist. So he came here back to India and he worked as a journalist. Now, Rudyard led an exciting life filled with journeys and interesting situations. In 1894, he published his most popular work, that is The Jungle Book. You all are very well aware of this name, The Jungle Book. It's a very famous book and the most popular work of Rudyard Kipling so far. This book, you know, helped many of the directors to come up with different kind of, you know, animated movies and normal movies as well. You might have seen Jungle Book movie as well. And this book talks about a boy Mowgli who was born brought up in jungle amongst the wild animals, and how he comes across various problems in his life, especially led by one of the antagonist, the tiger there, and you know how he overcomes all the situations. Now in 1907 he got a Nobel Prize. Now this Nobel Prize in literature was given to him because of his power of observation, originality of imagination, virility of ideas, and remarkable talent for narration, which characterized the creation of this world famous author. So these are the different qualities he possessed, and that is how he is characterized as the very creative famous author. Now, Tumai of Elephants, by Rudyard Kipling. Now, this Tumai of Elephant here, Tumai is a character who happens to be master of elephant, whose name is Kalanag. Now, this Tumai of Elephant is an excerpt from Jungle Book. What happens in this particular chapter is that the Tumai, who happens to be Kalanag's, master, has a 10-year-old son, little Tumai. Okay, and this elephant, now it is about the follow-up of adventures of the elephant Kalanag, and he was a special elephant. He served for the Indian government, who was at that time under British rule, and he did different assignments, but in the end worked on taming other elephant, as he was very good at it. Now Tumai knew Kalanag since he was a kid, and both of them, they were very good friends. And they came across, they come across many adventures on the Mount Garo. So this whole chapter deals with that. But what happens one day, Tumai feels that, elephant Kalanag feels that he has been kept captive for a very long time, and he wants to break free. He wants to just leave all these things behind and return to his own forest, return to his friends there in the forest. So this poem talks about freedom from bondage, realities, the relation between freedom and innocence, because in this chapter, to little Tumai was given a task by Peterson because he was very interested in the camp work, and he was never allowed there since he was only 10 years old. So he was given a task that if he sees dancing elephants, then he will be allowed to come in the camp. And at the end, with the help of Kalanag, he gets to see dancing elephant, which was a rare, very, very rare sight. Still, it is a very rare sight. So the moral here tells that if, our dream will come true only if we believe in them. So if we really believe on our dreams, it happens or it comes true. Now, let us read the poem to get a clearer picture. To my of the elephants, I will remember what I was. I'm sick of rope and chain. So here the elephant, Kala Nag, is talking to Tumai, little Tumai. And Tumai of the elephants here, Tumai is referring not to the name but the master. Because you remember that the old Tumai was actually the master of Kala Nag. So he is referring Tumai as master of the elephants. So he's telling that I will remember what I was. Here I is the elephant, and he's telling that he is never going to forget what he was in the past. He was not some sort of carrier, right? He is now. And he's telling that he's going to remember that he was full of strength, he was full of vigor. But I am sick of rope and chain. So he's telling, but now he's sick of rope and chain, which refers to the captivity, which refers to the bondage. So he wants to break free. And he wants to leave all these things, ropes and chains, because he's tired of all these things. I will remember my old strength and my all my forest affairs. So he's telling that he's never going to forget his old strength. So he's every time, it does not his old strength. Why is old being, used here? Strength, elephants are very strong. But old means the strength which was used by himself at his own will, not at someone else's command. Here his strength has been used at someone else's command. The master commands him and he has to use his strength. So he is referring to old strength, wherein he was free of all the ropes and chains, free of all bondages. And that is why he's telling bondage, and he's telling that he's not going to forget his old strength and all my forest affairs. Forest affairs means the activities that happens in the forest by the animals. I will not sell my back to man for a bundle of sugar cane. So he's telling that he is not ready anymore to give his back to people for carrying the bundle of sugar cane. So he's being used as a mode of transportation to move the objects or things from one place to another. So he's telling that he doesn't want to do that anymore. I will go out to my own kind and the wood folk in their lair. So he's telling that he wants to go back to his own kind. Own kind means his own kind of friends, his wood folk, his friends in the forest, in their lair. So lair means where the animals live, the homes of the animals. Then in the next stanza, it speaks again of his wishes and his aspirations. Let's see what it says. Now here it says, I will go out until the day, until the morning break. So he's telling that he wants to continuously just walk until the day, until the morning break. So the whole night he wants to walk until the morning breaks in. Out to the wind's untainted kiss, the water's clean caress. So he's telling that he wants to experience that wind's untainted kiss. Here, when you walk and it's breezy outside, the breeze flows through on your face as well, right? You can feel it on your skin. So he's telling that the wind's untainted kiss here means that the feeling of purity, the clean air. Now here in this camp, he feels very suffocated. So even though it's breezy out there, the wind is very suffocating to him. So he wants to go out of this, boundaries where he's been kept captive. And the water's clean caress. So water's clean caress again means the touch of clean water. He wants to experience the touch of clean water which is free of any kind of slavery or any kind of bondage. I will forget my ankle ring and snap my picket stake. So he's telling that he wants to forget, and when he's out there, he's going to forget everything that he's experiencing now, all the bitter experiences. He wants to forget his ankle ring. Now, when the animals are kept captive, they are, made to wear ring in their ankles. And snap my picket stake. So he wants to slip and break his wooden post where, the animals are tied. I will revisit my lost loves and playmates masterless. So he wants to visit his loved ones in the forest and his playmates with whom he used to play masterless. So they all are masterless because they are free from any human owner. So that is what he's speaking of. So he wants to just return to his life in jungle. Now, Here, you might have seen that beside every line, I have marked A, B, C, D in red. Now, this tells us about the rhyming scheme of the poem. In the first stanza, if you see, now how do you mark the rhyming scheme is what we are going to also learn today. Now, rhyming scheme, you all know what is rhyming words, you all know what is rhyming words. Rhyming words, you know, when it rhymes, the syllables, the last syllable, they rhyme together, like chain, sugar cane. So ain are the last syllable which are rhyming. So in the rhyming scheme, what you need to look at, you need to look at the last word of each line. Okay, now see, the first line is, I will remember what I was, I'm sick of rope and chain. So here chain is the first, I mean last word, so you are going to mark it as A. So you are going to sequentially mark each and every line. Then I will remember my old strength and all my forest affairs. So the last word is affairs. Now affairs, if you look at chain, is it rhyming with chain? No, it is not. So since chain was A, affairs will be B. So the second line will be B. Then the third line is, I will not sell my back to man for a bundle of sugar cane. Now sugar cane is rhyming with chain. So we are going to again mark it as A because it is rhyming with the first line, which is marked as A. Then I will go out to my own kind and the wood folk in their lairs. Now lairs is not rhyming with chain, so we are not going to mark it as A, but it is rhyming with affairs, which we have marked as B. So it becomes B. So what you are going to do, you are going to start with alphabet A and then in sequence you are going to write it. But the lines which rhymes with, the lines that rhyme together will have the same letter. Like here. So the rhyming scheme of the first stanza, if the question is asked to you, what is the rhyming scheme of the first stanza? It will be A, B, A, B. In the second stanza, if you see, it is, I will go out until the day, until the morning break. So it is break. Now break is not rhyming with chain. It is not rhyming with affairs. So A and B, we are not going to write. After B, what comes? C. So we are going to write C here. Out of the wind's untainted kiss, the water's clean caress. Now, caress again, it's not rhyming with A, that is chain and sugarcane. It is not rhyming with B also, that is affairs and lairs. It is not rhyming with break also, C. It is not rhyming with break. So, we are going to mark it as D, because D comes after C. I will forget my ankle ring and snap my picket stake. Now, stake here is rhyming with break. So, I'm going to mark it as C only. And then I will revisit my lost loves and playmates masterless. So masterless is rhyming with caress, so it becomes D. So the second stanza rhyming scheme is C, D, C, D. Okay, so I think I have made myself clear with rhyming scheme. Now children, I request you all to write all your doubts and queries in a notebook with the name of the topic on the top, so that when the school reopens, we can discuss these queries of and doubts of yours and we can clear it in the class through discussion. Now today is this something new that you're going to learn apart from the rhyming scheme. That is the figures of speech, or you might also call it as poetic device. Now these devices are used to make the poem more attractive and more poetic, okay, to have that element in it. Now there are many poetic devices. There's alliteration, there's onomatopoeia, there's hyperbole, there's synecdoche, many more, metaphor, simile. All these are poetic devices, but right now we are just going to do alliteration, because alliteration is something that is there in your poem. Now alliteration is what? It is the repetition of same initial sound and not letter in two or more than two words in a sentence. So in a sentence, if the same sound is repeated in two words or more than two words, then it becomes alliteration. Now, if you look at the first example, it's given, busy bee bites hard. So here, busy bee bites, burr, burr, burr. The sound is repeated. So it becomes alliteration. In the next example, the sea seen from a distance appeared beautiful. So here, sea seen, sir, the initial sound is repeated. So sea seen is your alliteration. Now in the poem, you have clean caress. So that is why it is alliteration. But if you see whole world, it is not a part of your poem, but just for a clearer understanding, I'm telling you whole world. See, the both the words are starting with W, but the sound is different. It is whole, her, and world, ver. So it is not an alliteration. So alliteration should necessarily have same initial sound and not letter. Alright, now this brings us to the end of Tumai of the Elephants and the different things that we have done. So we have done about Tumai of Elephant, two stanzas, line-wise summary. I've also explained you about rhyming scheme and alliteration, which happens to be the poetic devices used here. And in short about Rudyard Kipling. And as I've told you, if you have any doubt or query, kindly write it down in a notebook, and we shall discuss it once the school reopens. Thank you. Kindly read through the or go through the poem on your own once again. Thank you.